हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक। माय सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू हैव 3rd of May 2021, राइट? एंड एज यू नो दैट दीज लेक्चर्स आर बेस्ड ऑन करंट अफेयर्स, सो फॉर दैट पर्पस यू शुड स्टडी द नेशनल न्यूज़पेपर्स लाइक हिंदू और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers for your better preparation. You should read, okay, the Hindu. And apart from that, you can also refer these video lectures where you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. These lectures are also based on the current affairs. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube where these lectures are uploaded on the day-to-day basis. Alright? So, you can refer, or obviously, right? So let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is related to the Taiwan. Okay, as you know, the Taiwan is basically it's not a country. It's officially the China considered the Taiwan as its own part. Okay, so Taiwan does not have the diplomatic relations with India. It has the diplomatic relations with only say 14 countries. The China basically resists this move of having the diplomatic relations with the Taiwan. Whoever the country have the diplomatic relations with the China, sorry, with the Taiwan, the China basically cut off its own diplomatic relations with that country, because China is obviously and always considered the Taiwan as its own territory. Okay, but it has certain autonomy in their administrative function. Right. So, as you know that because of COVID-19 or Corona pandemic, right, the India is basically having the huge shortage of the medical oxygen as well as other equipments which are associated with the COVID. Right. So Taiwan is basically started sending those equipments and the medical oxygens like oxygen concentrators, oxygen cylinders, right, as well as other medical equipments, right, from Taiwan to India. It is the strong and a huge negligence from the government part, especially the government of India, who is not proactive of, you know, having, you know, any plan how to control this pandemic or how to manage this pandemic at all. Okay, and the result is the thousands of the people are just dying because of the absence of oxygen, absence of medical equipments, which are very vital, and government should be proactively acting of, you know, of managing those oxygens and cylinders, right, in advance. But now it's a simple case of negligence, right? So regarding Taiwan is officially known as the Republic of China, because the China is basically considered as its territory, as its part. Okay, so it is basically, if you see in the physical map of the world, right, you can easily find out that it is a basically state in East Asia. Okay, regarding the neighbor state, first of all, if you see in the map of any, you know, political map, you could easily find out the People's Republic of China, that is simply China. China lies to the west of the Republic of China, or simply the Taiwan. Okay, the Japan is another country which is also lying the neighbor to Taiwan. The Japan lies to the northeast of Taiwan. Okay, as well as the Philippines also there, right? Philippines lies to the south of Taiwan, right? And regarding the physical map, if you could look into that, you can easily find out certain seas or certain straits which are also lying closer to your Taiwan. So here the East China Sea basically lies to the north of, you know, Taiwan. The Philippine Seas lies to the east of Taiwan. Okay, the Luzon Strait directly lies to the south, right, as well as the South China Sea lies to the southwest of Taiwan. Okay. And the Taiwan Strait, right, which is basically a strait that is basically having a narrow passage, which basically separates the island of Taiwan from the mainland of China. So through the Taiwan Strait, you can easily get in touch of these two, you know, the Chinese mainland as well as the island of Taiwan. Okay, the strait is basically, the Taiwan Strait is currently a part of South China Sea, where the China is basically having some sort of a sovereignty or forced sovereignty over the South China Sea. Right, and this strait is also connected to the East China Sea to the north also. The capital of Taiwan is basically Taipei, which is the capital of Taiwan. Regarding the Luzon Strait basically lies to the south of Taiwan. The Luzon Strait is basically a strait between the Taiwan and the Luzon Island. That is why the name of the Luzon Strait is basically there. So it is a strait between Taiwan and the Luzon Island. The Luzon Island basically belongs to the Philippines, right? Philippines. So it basically connect the Taiwan with Philippines, right? If specifically the Luzon Islands, right? And you can say that hereby the Luzon Strait basically connects the Philippine Sea to the South China Sea, specifically in the West Pacific Ocean, okay? And this body of water is very important for the shipping and the communication channels, as you know about it. Regarding the Philippine Sea, as you know, the Philippine Sea is also called a marginal sea, right? Specifically, it is located in the West Pacific Ocean, right? If you could see the physical map, you could easily find out that it is located east of the Philippines archipelago, okay? And the Philippine Sea, since it is a marginal sea, so it's occupying the lesser area comparatively to the larger oceans. For example, it is having the area of around 5 million square kilometers only, okay? Now, as I told you that Taiwan is no longer a member of UN because it is not considered as an independent country, right? By almost all the member states, including the UN, since it is not a member of the UN, okay? Now, it has been replaced by, as I told you, it is also known as the Republic of China. Now, it has been replaced by the People's Republic of China in 1971, okay? As People's Republic of China become the member of UN, so it has been replaced by the People's Republic of China because PRC is also considered as a, this Taiwan as a part of the China, right? So the China as Taiwan is basically claimed by the PRC or People's Republic of China. This is simply, right? And the People's Republic of China or the China simply refuses the diplomatic relations with those countries, right? Whoever recognize the Republic of China, that is Taiwan. Simply, the China refused to have the diplomatic channels or diplomatic relations with those countries who simply recognize the Taiwan. Okay, and Taiwan maintains basically the official ties with 14 out of 193 countries, right? As well as the Holy See. The Holy See is basically, the Holy See is basically also called the See of Rome. The See of Rome, it is basically the jurisdiction of the Bishop of Rome, which is simply known as Pope. So you can see it is basically also known as the See of Rome, which is having the jurisdiction of the Pope or Bishop of Rome. Okay, and the bilateral relations between India and the Taiwan has improved because both countries have moved together to improve these bilateral relations despite of having the India and Taiwan does not have any diplomatic relations since 1990s. Right, so both of countries, their relations have been significantly improved. And here, this is the map where you can see the Taiwan, right? The capital is Taipei, right? Here you can see the mainland China or People's Republic of China. Here you have the Japan, the Ryukyu Islands belongs to the Japan. You have the Philippine Sea, right? You have South China Sea, right? So this is, you can easily find out in the map. Okay, next. You have the Rule 50. The Rule 50 basically belongs to the International Olympic Committee. Okay, so International Olympic Committee have come out with a rule called Rule 50. Okay, now what is this Rule 50? First of all, the Rule 50 basically is a rule that restrict or that prohibits the basically, the athletes to debate or to say any sort of expression or demonstration, right, which is basically related to some sort of the political propaganda or religious propaganda or racial propaganda, whatever may be, right, at any venue or, any area belongs to the International Olympic Committee, right? So here the decision have been taken because there were many athletes, right, who were basically protesting, right from the, in the Olympic area, right? It is this protest or demonstration is basically shown by, by the various athletes, right? This protest or the demonstration, though looks logical and looks rational, but the using of this platform as the Olympic area to vent out your grievances, right, it's not something right. So that is the reason the International Olympic Committee has banned any sort of a demonstration or political, you know, any sort of a, you know, the statement that is right from the Olympic area. The athletes should not be using this as a platform to vent out their grievances, right? So that was the reason the International Olympic Committee has recently been banned, right? Those athletes or, you know, any sort of a protest which is on the field or on the podiums or during the ceremonies of the Olympic, right? So this decision have been taken, and this decision have triggered the round of debate over the athletes' right of expression, because everybody has the right to express its own views, rights, its own ideas, right? This is also the most fundamental right, the natural right, which has been given to every person, including the athletes. But if you restrict those rights, definitely that will basically restrict the right to expression, right to speech, expression, etc. Okay, so here it simply forbids any kind of demonstration or which is basically based on the political or racial propaganda at the venues or any other place which is basically lying in the Olympic area. So let us understand first what is this International Olympic Committee. So International Olympic Committee is basically a non-governmental sports organization. Okay, it's a simply non-governmental sports organization which is basically based in the Lausanne in Switzerland. Okay, it's headquartered in Lausanne in Switzerland. It can, or you can say, it is basically constituted in the form of an association under Swiss Civil Code. So you can say at the last, the International Olympic Committee is a non-for-profit, the independent international organization, right, which is ultimately made up of the volunteers. And the International Olympic Committee basically presides over all its activities, right? And it is basically responsible for taking the main decisions of the organization. Okay, but why this, you know, all such propaganda and the political statements and demonstrations and all sort of resistance have been shown by the athletes? There was a reason for that. For example, in the USA last May, you might have seen also, you might have heard also, the death of a black person called George Floyd have triggered anti-racism protests specifically in the USA, right? The police basically, you know, murdered or simply killed the George Floyd in USA last year, right? The George Floyd, basically a black person. And this basically gave boost to the Black Lives Matter movement. And the Olympic body basically came under the pressure because many athletes basically started showing their you know, sympathy, their, you know, their support to the black body, the Black Lives movement, as well as with the George Floyd, right? And as well as to the anti-racist protest. So that was the reason, right? The International Olympic Committee has come out with the Rule 50 to banning any such protest or demonstration right from the Olympic area. Okay, so here subsequently the International Olympic Committee's Athletes Commission started a consultation process in the June last year, and it has taken the views of various athletes, say 3547 athletes, right? And this has recommended this rule that should be maintained in the Olympic area. Okay, regarding George Floyd, as you know, the George Floyd was basically an African American, right? And he was a black person. He was murdered by the police during an arrest after, you know, a store person or a store clerk basically alleged him that he has simply passed a counterfeit, right? You know, the $20 of, you know, the counterfeit, you know, billing that for that purpose in the Minneapolis. So what happens, a police officer, right, called the Derek Chauvin, right, who was also the person who was later accused and who was also convicted of murdering the George Floyd, has arrived. And he basically, you know, put his the feet on the neck of the George Floyd for at least 9 minutes and 29 seconds. And ultimately the George Floyd died because of suffocation, right? And that was the reason for that. And the Black Lives Matter movement, it is simply a social movement that is dedicated, you know, to fight the racism, the police brutality against the black people, all right? So here you can see here, the athletes basically showing their demonstration, their protest against, you know, the anti-racist, you know, the basically the propagandas or the Black Lives Matter movement or whatever it may be, right? It is showing an platform to demonstrate, right, to basically put forward their grievances related to some sort of a racism, ideologies and racism, features in the society. All right, next, CT scan. Everybody knows about the CT scan. Okay, it is also known as computed tomography scan or simply CT scan. Okay, now why this CT scan in the news? Because several COVID positive patients, these COVID positive patients who have the mild and moderate, COVID infections, right? They are rushing to have the CT scans, right? And even with negative COVID patient or negative RT-PCR reports patients, they are also rushing for the CT scan. So there is a huge rush for the CT scans, right from from the negative to the positive COVID patients. Okay, so what is the reason? What is the reason why the people or why the patients are rushing for that? It's a reason. I'll let you know just brief after that. So CT scan. What is CT scan? First of all, the CT scan is also known as computed tomography scan, which is also previously known as the computed axial tomography or simple CAT scan. Okay, it's a simply medical imaging technique that is basically used in the radiology, right? The main purpose is to get detailed images of any sort of the non-invasory for the diagnostic purpose. Okay, now why these patients are rushing for the CT scan? It is out of fear. It is out of fear, or it is also doctor's prescription, right? So what is happening is that along with laboratory testing, say you have conducted RT-PCR test or you have the RT-PCR report along with you, right? And many patients are rushing for the chest CT scans, right? So many people think that, or even doctors also think that it may be helpful to diagnose, the COVID-19 specifically in the individual with high clinical suspicion of infection. So it will be helping in diagnosis of any sort of individual that is having the high clinical suspicion of infection. Even doctors say that the COVID patients which is having the worsening conditions, specifically in the home isolation or in the hospitals, right, which is having the critical conditions, are generally recommended for RT, this CT scans, right? Even if the patient's oxygen level is going below 95, right, even during home quarantine or even in the hospitals, right, such patients should get their CT scan done to detect the infection level, how much the infection level is there in the chest, because the corona or simple novel coronavirus basically infect the lungs, right? So simply by taking the chest CT scan or chest scan, it may be able to find out, right, what is the level of infection level or what is the level of the infection in your chest or specifically in your lungs through this CT scan. So that is why the people are basically running for the CT scans. Okay, now the personnel basically that perform the CT scans are also known as radiographers or radiology technologists that you have seen also, right? And the CT scanners, which is the body, simple a machine which uses the rotating X-ray tube, okay, and which is also fitted with a row of detectors that are also placed, okay, and which is basically different type of the measurements have been taken from the different angles, and then we use basically technique called the reconstruction algorithms, right, through which the tomographic or cross-sectional images of a body is basically produced, right, through the computer. So here we use the ionization radiations, right, and which basically have also some sort of adverse effect also. Okay, here you have the CT scan where a technician or radiologist, perform some sort of a scanning over, the body of a person, right, who is basically undergoing this machine. Okay. Next, the G7. G7, you can say the group of seven. The group of seven. It is simply a group of seven countries. Okay. So here, right, the group of seven countries, the external or the foreign ministers meeting, right, of the group of seven countries is going to be held specifically in London, right? So here our external affairs minister Mr. S. Jayashankar will basically took the part in the meetings of the foreign ministers of G7 countries that will be going to be held in the London. And India was basically invited to this meeting as a guest country. So regarding G7, the G7 is also known as the Group of Seven. It is basically consisting of the seven countries, right? The Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, UK, and USA. Okay, so what you can say that it is simply an intergovernmental organization. It is simply an intergovernmental organization consisting of the seven countries. Okay, the heads of the government of the member countries as well as the representatives of the European Union, they basically meet in the annual G7 summit that is basically held annually. Okay, so here the G7 nations basically meet in the annual summits, right, that are presided by the leaders of the member countries, right, that is basically specifically from the seven member countries on the rotation basis. And this summit is basically informal gathering, right, and that generally lasts for the 2 days, and where the leaders specifically from the G7 countries, they discuss, right, lot of issues related to the global issues, right. And it does not have any sort of a formal constitution or fixed headquarters, right. And they basically meet in such a informal meeting, and the decisions which are taken by the leaders, they are non-binding. They are non-binding. That means they are simply recommendatory in the nature. They are simply recommendatory in nature. They are not binding on the members. Okay. So here you can easily find out the member states like Canada, USA, UK, Germany, Italy, France, and Japan. These are the seven founding members of the G7 countries. All right. Next, the SpaceX. As you know, the SpaceX is basically, you know, a firm which is related to the Elon Musk. So it is basically the firm which is also excelling in the space programs. So SpaceX capsule, which have taken the four astronauts to the International Space Station, now also completed, right? Round trip that has also brought down the four astronauts safely from International Space Station. And the SpaceX capsule have successfully splashed down in the Gulf of Mexico on 2nd May 2021, bringing back the four astronauts from International Space Station. So, as you know, the American space agency called NASA have said that the return of four astronauts from the International Space Station after their stay of around 168 days, right, have completed, right, the first operational round trip mission, right, belongs to the SpaceX capsule, right, which have also successfully completed their mission also. Okay, now this return to Earth belonged to the, you know, to the indigenous American, right, a capsule is the second such splashdown after Apollo 8, which was lasted in 1968, when the first motion to the orbit, right, the moon was successfully conducted, and then splashing down was occurred in 1968. After that, it is the second chances when such splashdown for the NASA astronauts was done. And here, this SpaceX capsule was basically, you know, built under the public-private partnership with the SpaceX. So NASA and SpaceX both are collaborating here for the purpose of the building of any such the capsules. And here the Elon Musk is basically a founder of the SpaceX, which is also, you know, a newly built company in 2002 for the purpose of the space exploration, for the purpose of building the rockets, and, you know, for the purpose of exploring the, especially the surface of Mars. And the Elon Musk is also the CEO of electric car maker Tesla Inc. So here you can see the capsule which has been splashed down, right, in the Gulf of Mexico. And here you have the rescuers which immediately came in the night, and they rescue all of the four astronauts which came down successfully. Okay. Next, the goods and the service tax. As you know that GST have been implemented by the government of India, right? But you must understand that because of COVID pandemic or corona pandemic, now the people are finding very difficult to file this GST, GST, right? So government has announced certain relaxation or certain relief measures for the taxpayers, that they will be provided certain relief in terms of reduction the penalty, right? In terms of giving more time for the taxpayer to pay the GST. Okay, so certain, you know, reduction in their interest rate and waiving of the late fee have been announced by the Ministry of Finance in the notification. Okay, so here those persons who are basically having the turnover or having the aggregate turnover of around of over 5 crore rupees, right? So there the lower interest rate of 9% will be applicable for the first 15 days after due date. Okay, and then 18% will be, you know, charged as a interest rate thereafter, after your completion of 15 days, right? Specifically for the tax period of March and April 2021. And that is only applicable for the taxpayers who is having the turnover of above 5 crore rupees. Okay. And then the second category of the, you know, taxpayers who is having, right, you know, the turnover up to 5 crore rupees, that is not exceeding 5 crore rupees. So here, you know, you don't have to pay any sort of interest for the first 15 days, right, after your due date. And then subsequently, you have to pay only 9% of interest rate in the next 15 days. So first 15 days, 0% interest rate. Next 15 days, only 9%. And thereafter, 18% will be paid. And that will be applicable to those who are quarterly return, right, or who are having the monthly payment of taxes scheme, specifically for the month of March and April 2021. Okay, next. In the third category of the investors who is having the aggregate turnover of about 5 crore rupees, right, they have to pay, right, the late fee, or they, their late fee will be waived for 15 days, right? But for that purpose, they have to file and form called form GSTR 3B. GSTR 3B should be furnished beyond the due date, right? Specifically for the tax period of these 2 months. Now, what is this form GSTR 3B? Your form GSTR 3B is basically a consolidated summary return of inward and outward supplies that the government of India has, you know, introduced as a way of tax, way of relax, you know, requirement of the business that have recently been transitions to, you know, your GST. And the next category of the investors is that the turnover of that investor, say up to 5 crore rupees, right, the late fee can be waived for 30 days, right, for the GSTR 3B return that is furnished beyond the due date. Okay. And also the Finance Ministry also extended the due date of filing the form GSTR 1, right, as well as the invoice furnishing facility for the month of April due to the COVID-19 pandemic, that is being extended by the 15 days. And here the GSTR 1 or form GSTR 1 is basically a sales return that is required to be filled by every GST registered person. Okay. So the taxpayers who are to enter the details relevant of their sales and outward supplies in the GSTR sales return. Okay. Next, the World Press Freedom Day. As you know that the world celebrate every May 3rd, right? So every year May 3rd celebrate as a World Press Freedom Day. Okay, the World Press Freedom Day is basically have, you know, proclaimed by the United Nations General Assembly in December 1993. Okay, the United Nations General Assembly have proclaimed this World Press Freedom Day, right, after the UNESCO's General Conference have recommended for that purpose. Okay, so the May 3 basically is also an anniversary of the declaration of Windhoek, right, which is also celebrated worldwide as a World Press Freedom Day. So here in that day, the declaration of the Windhoek is also the most prominent. What is this Windhoek declaration? See, Windhoek declaration is basically, you know, for the development of a free and independent and pluralistic press. So Windhoek declaration is a statement of press freedom principles, which are specifically brought down by the African newspaper journalist in 1991, right? And subsequently, the United Nations General Assembly have proclaimed the May 3 as you know, as a word press freedom day, right? Regarding objectives of this word freedom press freedom day, right? In this day, right, the world basically celebrate the fundamental principles of the press freedom, right? It will also celebrate the access to the state of press freedom throughout the world, right? It will also, you know, in this day, we will also try to defend the media from the attacks, right? That basically reduces its independence, right? As well as we also try to pay our tribute to the journalists, right, who have lost their life, right, in the line of their duty of journalism. Okay, and this year's theme for the World Press Freedom Day is the information as a public good, right? That should be free flowed from, you know, from every corner, and that type of information should not be based on any biased criteria, right? And it's also, you know, we call to affirm the importance of the cherishing information, right, which is factually correct, right, and it is also considered as a public good, right, that will brought the maximum good for the public also. Okay, so here you have the World Press Freedom Day 2021, every 3rd May, and the theme for this year is basically the information as a public good, basically is the theme, and it is also celebrate the 30 years of the Windhoek celebration. Okay, next, the Satyajit Ray Film and Television Institute. Okay, so as you know that government has decided to celebrate a year-long celebrations, right, as the World Sanitary Celebration of, you know, the famous, you know, Satyajit Ray, right, who was also the famous director, actor, right, which belongs to the film industry. Okay, so the institute called Satyajit Ray Film and Television Institute have decided to organize a virtual convocation this year, right? The virtual convocation was held on May 2nd, 2021. That was on Sunday. So in that, you know, in that the convocation was held virtually. Regarding the Satyajit Ray Film and Television Institute, it is basically a film and television institute which is located in Kolkata, West Bengal. And here, you know, it is named after the most renowned filmmaker Satyajit Ray, right, which also provide, or this institute provide, the higher and the professional education and technical expertise specifically in the arts and the techniques of filmmaking and television productions to the different, you know, segments of the people. Okay, regarding this institute, it's been you know, set up in 1995 as an autonomous society which has been funded by the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, Government of India. Okay, and the Satyajit Ray Film and Television Institute, or simply SRFTI, is one of the most prestigious film schools in India, and also it is also among the one of the world best schools in the world also, right? It has been noted or regarded the best film and television institute along with the Film and the Television Institute of India, that is FTTI, as well as the National School of the Drama, right? So let us take the brief introduction about the Film and Television Institute of India. The Film and the Television Institute of India is basically an autonomous civil services training institute for the Indian Information Service cadre under Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, Government of India, and definitely it has been added by the central government. Okay, regarding the National School of Drama, you know about it. The National School of Drama is basically a theater training institute which is currently located in New Delhi, right? It is an autonomous organization which comes under the Ministry of Culture, Government of India. Okay, it was set up in 1959 by Sangeet Natak Academy. Okay, it has been set up by Sangeet Natak Academy in 1959, and now it has become an independent school in 1975. So since 1975, it has become an independent school. Okay, so here the person called Satyajit Ray. Okay, next, the Sutra model. Okay, so Sutra model, let us first understand Sutra model, then we'll go to the news. See, Sutra model is basically a mathematical model or mathematical modeling approach, right, for basically for the COVID pandemic, right? So what happens is, right, to find out the trend of the COVID pandemic, a mathematical modeling approach that we call Sutra model was basically adopted. So Sutra is basically also stand for the susceptible undetected, susceptible undetected tested. Okay, tested means here I am considering the positive, okay, and removed approach. So it is a mathematical modeling which is known as susceptible undetected tested. Here we are considering positive and removed approach, that is called Sutra model. Simply a model that is basically try to get the trend of the COVID pandemic, right, specifically in the symptomatic patients, specifically that have the symptomatic, you know, the patients. And it is a the novel feature that is basically to find out any sort of a trends, and various other scientists are basically working with the Sutra model. So here the scientists of which are working with the Sutra model have recently been rejected the media report that they have cautioned the government of India regarding the second wave of corona pandemic. So the media have recently been reported that the scientists belong to the Sutra model have recently, you know, have already, you know, cautioned the government regarding the second wave of pandemic, and government has not taken any measure proactively. In simple, it's a negligence of all the part of government. Many people are dying because of corona, and government is it's insensitive and not proactive in managing of this pandemic in India specifically, and that shows in the form of the, you know, the shortage of oxygen, shortage of medical supply, shortage of beds, right? Even after 14 months, even the Madras High Court also asked the central government, what are you doing in last 14 days, 14 months? You have not, you don't have any plan to implement for managing this pandemic. Simple, yeah, negligence. So here the Sutra model basically used for the charting of the trajectory of COVID-19 in the country. Okay, it's a simple, right? It's a simple a model for the trajectory of COVID-19. It's a simply a mathematical model, right? So here the group of scientists basically working with the model, right, which can basically can predict the, you know, any sort of a future, right? As long as it can predict this future, only when you have the certainty of the virus dynamics and the transmissibility, right? Otherwise it will be very difficult to predict. Okay, and it is also, you know, that the nature of the virus have been changing very rapidly, so it will be very difficult to predict, and any sort of a prediction must be continuously readjusted based on the realities, right? And scientists basically working with the Sutra model, right, they have continued to use their effort, right, to bring the better trajectory to control this pandemic in our country. Okay, next, the converting nitrogen plants to the oxygen plants. Now, because of COVID-19 pandemic, because of shortage of oxygen, now the government of India is planning to convert the nitrogen plants into oxygen plants. Right? They have no option but to do. Previously, they have not thought, but now many people is dying, and it is huge pressure on the government of India. Now they are doing like hell for converting everything into the oxygen plants. Even for your information, I'll tell you, the government of India took 8 months for the tendering process for 150 medical oxygen plants. 8 months they took. Why are so much 8 months they took for tendering process only? Why would have not they have done this tendering process, say, in 8 days or 10 days or 15 days? Because it's a pandemic, it's an emergency, right? So the government machinery is very slow in tendering process and all sort of things. So it's very, very difficult to manage this pandemic in India. Okay. So anyhow, so here the government of India is planning to have the conversion of these nitrogen plants that basically produces the nitrogen, right? These nitrogen plants will be converted to the oxygen plant that can convert the oxygen, right? So here the government of India is basically exploring the feasibility of converting this nitrogen plants into oxygen plants. So here the various approaches have been adopted, right? Definitely only certain plants which have the cruciality in terms of the production of the nitrogen will be spared. Otherwise, other plants will be identified for the purpose of converting, right, the nitrogen into the oxygen. So here, the process of converting the oxygen pressure swing absorption nitrogen plants for the production of oxygen was basically discussed. So here, you must understand, for the production of nitrogen, what you need is carbon molecular sieve. The carbon molecular sieve is basically used for the production of nitrogen. And the production of oxygen, you need the zeolite molecular sieve, right, which is required for the production of oxygen. So what they are planning to do, they are planning to replace this carbon molecular sieve with the zeolite molecular sieve in order to produce the oxygen, right? Apart from this, this replacement of this carbon molecular sieve with the zeolite molecular sieve, they are also have to adjust different other features, like they have to change the oxygen analyzer, the control panel system, the flow valves, and etc., and many other, you know, the mechanical instrument that they have to change, and then only they can be modified to produce the oxygen. And here, the nitrogen plants, once modified, they can get, you know, this oxygen from these plants, so they can be shifted to the nearby hospital, or even from the existing location, they can produce the oxygen, and there, from there, the medical oxygen can be transported to the hospitals, to the specialized vessels, and to the cylinders. All right. So that thing we can do here. So you can see here, the oxygen is produced and being stored in the cylinders. Okay. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. Take care of yourself. And we'll meet tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you very much.